joint work with many colleagues at Innovation Factory, so including students and members of our group here in the room, and some of them will be talking later as well. I would like to start by explaining the key words geometric data science, because this area was introduced for the first time at the last MaxMin in September 2022. At that moment, we realized that our research went beyond periodic structures. So it's not only periodic geometry, we now consider some finite objects as well. So examples here, so by data, we mean, for example, so point clouds, molecules, and protein chains. So usually when we consider a real data object, it is given in some digital form, in a representation that can be ambiguous. In what sense? In the sense that different representations may actually refer to the same object, equivalent or identical. However, it is important to clarify this meaning of same. And I very like to quote the title of the paper. So this is the real paper, so written not by me, but by other people. But the title, I think, is great. Same or different, that is the question. So it was about crystal structures, actually, exactly on our topic. But other people started to ask this question. And geometric data science will answer these questions for different types of objects. But let me start from a simple example of a periodic lattice. So lattice is defined by a linear basis. So it could be done in any high-dimensional space. Pictures here are two-dimensional for simplicity. So we could take the standard orthonormal basis of two vectors v1, v2, and generate the infinite collection of linear combinations with integer coefficients. So all these black points, they form the infinite lattice. However, we could generate exactly the same set of black points by using a different pair of vectors. For example, the vectors that form this red unit cell or a more narrow blue cell, they generate exactly the same square lattice. And even more, so what happens if you look at the second picture? So hopefully it's easy for you to see that they should be considered in a certain sense equivalent. We simply shifted our points from corners of cells to centers. Or I guess you have recognized also a rotation by 45 degrees. Yes, correct, Elspeth. How about the last picture? Do you think it's the same or different in your opinion?
It's the same.
Why?
Because the points are in the same place, but the lines are not, and it makes it look completely different. It makes it look like you've sheared it.
Yeah, well,
that's perfect. One point is missing.
Both correct. Elspeth, you're a very experienced crystallographer. That's great. And Nick, you also noticed that, yeah, there is slight differences, but how did I produce the last picture? I simply took the previous picture, erased green lines, drawn them in a different way, and yes, changed a couple of points. But anyway, this is a finite region of an infinite lattice. Yes, but still we need to... Well, state formally, what do we mean by equivalent lattices or other objects? Okay, slightly more general. If you consider a periodic crystal, or here mathematically we consider a periodic point set. So we similarly start from a basis. That linear basis defines a unit cell, so parallelogram in two dimensions from the previous pictures. But in addition, to define a periodic point set, we need a finite motif of points in this unit cell. These points are, of course, atomic centers, centers of atoms or molecules. And then we generate from this finite motif and the lattice, so-called Minkowski sum. So the infinite sum, a vector from a lattice, a point from a motif, and all these infinite sums, they form a larger infinite periodic point set. And this picture shows that our ambiguity of this traditional classical representation becomes even worse, because we can fix a unit cell, that green square cell fixed, But for different motifs, you could generate exactly the same periodic point set on, or more exactly the same up to translation. So you could translate with periodic point sets and make them identical. So what do we have? We have different pairs, and what is important, infinitely many different pairs of a basis and a motif, they give rise to certain equivalent sets, sets that we will consider equivalent. So finally, what do you mean by equivalence? Equivalence is a very general concept in mathematics. So since not all here mathematicians, I recall the basic, with basic definition. So it's a binary relation between objects. So two objects of the same time, we could call equivalent or not. And this relation, if it is an equivalence relation, should satisfy three elementary axioms. Reflexivity means that any object should be always equivalent to itself. That sounds trivial, right? Symmetry, just a little bit less trivial. If the first object is equivalent to the second, A is equivalent to B, then B should be equivalent to A. And the most non-trivial axiom, transitivity, means that if A is equivalent to B and B is equivalent to C, then A should be equivalent to C. All three axioms are important, but especially the transitivity axiom is important to guarantee a well-defined classification, or more exactly, a splitting of all our objects into disjoint classes. Because the transitivity axiom implies that if two classes share a common point, then these two classes should coincide. So all these points in these two classes should be actually in the same class. That's why classes become disjoint. And there are many examples of an equivalence relation, for example, equality, which we study, equality between numbers we study in primary school. So one number, one half, can be written down in many different ways, different representations of the same object. So equality is an equivalence. That's why, well, we could start studying it from a very early age. Now, in practice, of course, there is noise. And sometimes it's very tempting to say that if two objects are very close to each other, almost identical, let's call them equivalent. Now, what happens mathematically with this approach? If you fix a threshold and say that one lattice is equivalent to another lattice up to a very small perturbation, so that we change coordinates of lattice vectors by small d, which could be really small, but strictly positive, then this picture hopefully illustrates to you that we can gradually perturb our initial basis and make our initial lattice transform it continuously into any other lattice by very small gradual perturbations. Actually, the last lattice here is exactly the same as the previous one, right? The square unit lattice, but with a different basis. And the transitivity axiom mathematically implies that if you say that two lattices, for example, are equivalent up to a certain threshold, then transitivity axiom implies that all our lattices should be equivalent. So that's why this equivalence relation is not suitable, but we can do better. We can measure noise, and it's important, of course, to measure difference between an ideal structure and a noisy structure, with radiation damage, for example. But what is important is not to fix a threshold, because if you fix a threshold, mathematically it becomes trivial by the transitivity axiom. Actually, feel free to ask questions during the talk. Yeah, completely okay. So classically, crystallography considered crystals for a long time equivalent if they have isomorphic space groups. So briefly recall that a space group consists of isometries, so transformations of ambient space that keep our underlying periodic structure invariant, for example, lattice translations. So in general, in any Euclidean space, actually any isometry decomposes into elementary translations, rotations, and mirror reflections. So that's a definition of an isometry. But when we look at the real crystal structure, and yes, not everyone has seen that example in my hand yet, But this is a crystal of, so for anyone who did.
Oh, silver.
Huh? Yes, yeah, you remember, Nicol, yes, yeah. Thank you. Yes, so recommended by John Halliwell, by the way, because it's an example of a crystal which is pure. That's why it is used in modern electronics. It's very close to ideal periodic crystal structure. But that's how it looks in the rough form. So when you look at a real crystal, this one or rock mineral, you notice that it looks solid, but more exactly a rigid body. So when we translate or rotate it and keep the same ambient conditions, room temperature, pressure, then we do not change that crystal structure. We should consider it the same under rigid motion. So that's why rigid motion defines the strongest equivalence relation in practice. So of course we could shift our atomic coordinates in a sig file and get a different representation, but this would make sense to distinguish. Rigid motion is simply the strongest in practice. If we all know that atoms vibrate with rotation, radiation damage, yes, but that's why it's important to see a difference. So if we measure the same material under different temperature, then diffraction pattern will give us slightly different atomic coordinates or maybe even unit cell parameters. But that's why it's important to see them as slightly different, but keeping the rigid motion as the strongest equivalence. So only for simplicity, we will additionally add mirror reflections. So what we talk about general isometries, but this is only a small difference because we can easily detect mirror images by adding the sign of orientation. So that's why we'll talk mostly about isometries. Why isn't the point, or was it known already? So it was a bit surprising to see that crystallographers actually are still discussing the definition. So this was in April 2021, so about 2 years ago only. There is still a discussion, what is the crystal? What should be the definition? So more exactly, this particular paper actually considered it as a more complicated case of aperiodic structures. However, I would say even the periodic case, I haven't seen that definition in textbooks. So what is our suggestion is to define a periodic crystal not as a single periodic structure with fixed atomic coordinates as in a sieve file, but as a class of structures that are all equivalent to each other up to rigid motion. So any translation or rotation produces only a different representation, but of the same crystal structure. So equivalence up to isometry or slightly stronger rigid motion. If you have seen somewhere published that in the literature, I would be happy to add a reference, but I haven't found.
I think that's the intrinsic understanding of the people, right? Like,
great. One happy, it's, I mean, not controversial.
Yeah, I mean, the folks always talk about the origin of the cell and snap. I kind of know the stuff, but it's, I guess, not formalized.
Yes. So that's why this is only the start. One more motivation why it is important. It is important because
You're only getting hot water with the flow of the scoop. Exactly, this discussion, like the equating crystals with periodicity, is a heresy now. I don't agree with that. I think sure. That we're, we better to define the crystal as being having periodicity, but actually that's not the definition.
I completely agree. So in my slides, so sometimes I write periodic crystal to make it explicit, but sometimes only because the space is small, I keep the word crystal, but I still mean periodic crystal. Yeah. So everything is about ideal periodic crystal so far.
Yeah.
We understand that there are other more general quasi-periodic, aperiodic crystals. Yes, of course, they're important. So long range order, sharp diffraction peaks. Yes, we understand that, but our research so far is already technical enough for periodic structures. Yes, thank you. Thank you, Simon. So one more motivation, some of you might know the story that even the Cambridge Structural Database is investigating nearly 1,000 materials because they came from a so-called paper mill. And that's why it's important to see the difference, to understand whether we have different crystal structures and if they're different, how much they differ. So to distinguish crystal structures, or actually any objects up to an equivalence relation, mathematicians use the concept of an invariant. In applied sciences, other words are used, descriptors or features. But let me give the definition, formal definition of an invariant. So an invariant is a property that has the same value on all equivalent objects. For example, for the hexagonal lattice, we could start from different representations. So different unit cells, for example, given by different coordinates of basis vectors. But an invariant should map all these different representations into a single value. Single value for a hexagonal lattice and for different representations of the square lattice, an invariant should give similarly one single value. Then it is called an invariant, that function or property. And in the language of computer science, it means this feature or invariant has no false negatives. So false negatives is so it's a pair of different representations of equivalent objects. Okay, a little bit more formally. If two objects are equivalent, isometric crystals, then the invariant takes the same value. So that's one version of the definition. And alternatively, an equivalent version. If an invariant takes different values on two objects, then our underlying objects should be not equivalent, should be different. So this is the definition of an invariant. And then if we have this property, this definition, then this invariant is actually useful to distinguish crystals, because if values are different, then we can be 100% sure that there are no false negatives, then our objects are really different.
Is it a one value or a vector? Or
good question. So I could be anything. So I is a function from a complicated space, for example, space of periodic structures, usually into a simple space, say numbers, or it could be vectors or matrices, or mathematicians use more complicated algebraic objects, but where it's easier to compare values. So when I write here, IS is not equal to IQ. So this could be an equality or non-equality between rather complicated objects, but they should be easier to compare than initial objects. So you will see vectors and matrices mainly in our invariants. But invariant could be simpler. An invariant could be a trivial function, mapping everything to zero. That's also an invariant. That's why we're interested not only in invariants, but in strong invariants. Ideally, this should be complete or sometimes like called injective. So the formal definition is here. An invariant is complete if this equality between invariant values actually means that our underlying objects are the same. So our invariant is so strong that it distinguishes all non-equivalent objects. For example, for humans, the birthday is an invariant because, well, one person, one birthday. So if two people have different birthdays, these people are different, but this birthday is not complete. Mm-hmm. So in a large group of students, you can with high probability find different students with the same birthday. So that's not a complete invariant. But DNA code is usually considered complete for humans. So to identify humans in serious situations like court trials. You're absolutely right. I actually know the probability, approximate probability of what happening. One in 300,000, if I'm correct. But yes, almost, yeah. You're absolutely right. But theoretically, yes, there could be two different people with the same DNA code, but still in practice, it's almost complete. But you're right. We will be looking for even stronger, theoretically complete invariants. So how this problem was approached in the past. So we, since our underlying structures are infinite and periodic, but we and computers prefer finite objects, it's very tempting to take a finite subset. So unfortunately, this doesn't work for the following reasons. So you see here, in the background, like hexagonal lattice, but you could take similarly any periodic structure and get easily similar counterexamples. So you could take a box of the same size, but in different locations. And this box will even contain different numbers of points inside. So if you take only a box and forget about everything else, about unit cell basis, then we will see these boxes as different objects, forgetting about where what we came from the same underlying periodic structure. So this works for axis aligned boxes or inclined boxes or balls. So for any periodic structure, these examples are easy to construct. So that's one difficulty. Hard to justify taking a finite subset. But if you remember about a unit cell, which is again a traditional approach, then there is another difficulty. If you focus on a unit cell, and yes, of course, there are primitive unit cells of a minimal volume, and there are reduced cells as rectangular as possible. The best known is probably Nigley cell. When this reduction to a reduced cell is unfortunately discontinuous under tiny perturbations. So a simple example on the left. Similarly working for any periodic structure. Square lattice and smallest unit square unit cell. But if you slightly shift every other point here, then this primitive unit cell becomes twice larger. So immediately we have a near duplicate structure with a very small difference, but a unit cell has doubled its volume, or it could triple its volume, or it can change any number of times. And it may not be rectangular, so I could easily draw a different picture where it will be only P1 translational symmetry. So that's the difficulty where a symmetry group breaks down. The density actually remains under these perturbations, in my examples, remains constant. So this is actually a good invariant, physical density, grams over cubic centimeters. It's a good continuous invariant, but it's just one number. And we need more numbers to uniquely identify a crystal structure. So that's why we will be looking for more numbers, but which are provably continuous under perturbations. So not using a reduced cell, not using symmetry groups. And why is it important? Because atoms vibrate. Yes, proteins get damaged by radiation. So you get a slightly different structure. Our data is noisy and there are too many crystals. So 230 classes space groups in a three-dimensional space. But this was a great discovery for the 19th century, proved by Fedorov and Schoenflies. And now we are in the 21st century where the Cambridge structural database contains more than 1.2 million structures, and 230 groups are not enough to distinguish them. We need to see that continuous space beyond all the structures. So, since I'm a mathematician, I state the problem formally here. So, first in two lines, we are looking for an easy, continuous, and complete isometry invariant for discrete sets of unlabeled points. So far, we considered only periodic point sets. However, the finite case is also interesting and non-trivial, simply finite sets of unlabeled points. So although I have hopefully discussed already all keywords, I briefly write down this requirement. So invariance means that our function I is an invariant, so it has no false negatives. And as a result, this function I is defined not only on representatives, but on classes, on isometric classes of our objects. Second condition, completeness, is much stronger. So it's much harder to satisfy because we need to distinguish all infinitely many of them. Infinitely many isometric classes, it's really hard to distinguish. But if we stop here at these two conditions, there is actually a very trivial mathematical solution to that problem. We could define the invariant I saying I is the a collection of all images of periodic structures under all possible isomorphs. So that's infinite object. Yeah, formally it's correct, yes. So let infinite collection, infinite union. Yes, it is an invariant, but it's not useful because we don't know how to compare this infinite size invariants. That's why our third condition, computability coming from computer science, means what we would like to have an algorithm computing with invariants and a later matrix fast enough. So ideally in a nearlinear time in the input size. And for a periodic structure, our input size is the number of points in a unit cell.
Just quickly, sure. Computability may be actually infinite. Would that be easier to say finite here? Because if the if your vector or number is just finite, it's have a certain set. Isn't it better? Isn't it
actually is? Yeah. Yeah, of course, our output should be finite because mm-hmm. we need to compute that in a nearlinear time or polynomial time in the input size. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. So computability here is just a general word, but I specify that the computational complexity should be fast enough in terms of the input size. Okay. But there are two more requirements. What were not, I think, considered previously. First, continuity. So continuity to tackle all this past discontinuity problems of symmetry groups. So in mathematics, it's called Lipschitz continuity, actually. So what it means? It means that if we perturb every atom up to epsilon, so shift its position, then we get a slightly different object, S, but this invariant, the invariant of this perturbation should be close to the invariant of the original object. But to make this comparison, we need a metric on invariant values. So for example, on vectors, so more complicated objects, but this metric should be explicitly defined. And that metric, so this word metric in mathematics means a distance function, a distance metric. So it's not it's not a single value for a single object. It's a single value for two objects, for a pair. So invariant of S, invariant of Q, satisfying three axioms. So three more axioms for a metric. First axiom means that the distance is zero only on identical or isometric crystals in our case. And this first axiom, actually, if you have such a metric, solves the equivalence problem. Because to check whether two objects are equivalent, we simply compute this distance metric on them and check whether it is zero or not. Second condition, symmetry and the triangle inequality, yeah, the same as from school geometry is illustrated here on the left. But last condition, invertibility, which was also mentioned several times today in different talks, it would be nice also not to have only a strong, complete and continuous invariant, but also a simple enough invariant. Simple in what sense? In the sense that we could describe the space of all realizable values of this invariant. So that we could pick a new value in that space and reconstruct explicitly our full object, for example, a three-dimensional crystal. Again, in a polynomial time with respect to the input size. And yes, people tried it before, but mostly the approaches produce so-called approximate metrics because when we would like to incorporate rigid motion in our comparison, even if you fix, say, for a finite object, the center of mass at the origin, there are still infinitely many rotations. And most past metrics are minimized over with infinitely many rotations. So very briefly, since PLDT was mentioned several times, and many of you know also TM score used for proteins. I only briefly mentioned that these scores, unfortunately, not metrics. So I have a specific example for TM here, but AlphaFold is based on this local distance difference test, LDDT. Well, the definition was a bit too long, so I simply included a screenshot here. And yeah, I'm not going to explain because it's rather technical. Very briefly, it depends on several thresholds listed here. So that's why actually you could guess it might be discontinuous, because when we go over a threshold, we make a different conclusion. But actually, the AlphaFold paper refers to this initial to the initial definition in Mariani et al. And that paper 10 years ago in the conclusion sections has the following phrase. So one disadvantage of this LDDT is that it's not a mathematical metric. So simply written in the conclusions. So that's why. So why it is important? So it is important because if you don't have a metric, don't have a triangle axiom, for example, then results of clustering can be predetermined. In what sense? So you could adversarially design a non-metric failing the triangle axiom with any small positive additive error and get your desired clustering after that. So this is a very recent paper, but it's mathematically proved. So that's why it's important to satisfy the basic axioms of a metric. Okay, this is a summary of all descriptors that were previously used in the past. So unfortunately, atomic coordinates are still used, for example, by applying many rotations. I have seen papers that applied, say, 1,000 rotations to a motif. But it makes the problem actually 1,000 times harder, because you have many more non-invariant representations. What would be much better is to have an invariant, well, which is non-trivial, non-constant, but it is also continuous. And there are such invariants, for example, pair distribution function. Yes, this is a nice invariant. So the only problem is it's not complete. So there are, for example, homometric crystals known from 1939. That have the same diffraction pattern, but they are different in the sense that are not isometric. That's why we'd like to have stronger invariants, so even stronger than PDF. So I give that example later, but the ultimate goal. The ultimate goal is not only to have a complete invariant and a metric, but describe the space. So previous attempts were to find so-called latent space. So map complicated objects into something simpler. But what ideally we would like to do is not to lose any information when we map into this latent space. In mathematics, these spaces are called moduli spaces of equivalence classes. For example, for lattices, how does it look? The space of all lattices, modular rigid motion and uniform scaling. So you will see a picture shortly. Because see, 230 classes, in a sense, it is a latent space. You map all periodic crystals into 230 numbers or labels, but they are disjoint. You could connect them into a graph. But from a geometric point of view, a metric on them would be discrete. So say if they are different, you could choose a value, non-zero value, but it is a discrete metric, and actually the underlying topology is trivial. But the answer for two-dimensional lattices, so modular rigid motion, the uniform scaling, is simple. But again, I haven't seen it written in the literature. It is a punctured sphere, and experts in number theory, some of them at least, when I ask this question, they give answers close to that space, but I was surprised it wasn't written before. So that's the space which will be discussed in the talk by Matt right after me. That's why I don't spend any more time, but only show the difference. So previously, what crystallography knew about two-dimensional lattices is this collection of five Bravais classes. Yes, they could be connected into a tree, but with singular classes, so for square, hexagonals, primitive rectangular, they actually singular subspaces in the full infinite continuous space. For example, all square lattices at that point with all hexagonal lattices. And yes, there is a continuous deformation from a square lattice to a hexagonal lattice through with centered rectangular lattices here. So the underlying space is continuous. And for two-dimensional lattices, that problem that I stated formally before is now fully solved with all conditions, including invertibility and geographic style map. So that's a map. And yes, it comes from the CSD. Matt will talk more about that. So this is for map. And since I should finish soon, let me also advertise the talk by Dan tomorrow at 10 o'clock. So now a PhD student Dan Widowson will talk about more general case periodic crystals. And here I introduce only the simplest invariant. So indeed it is a vector we called average minimum distance vector. So since the definition is simple, let me illustrate it for square lattice and hexagonal lattice. Say one point is at origin up to translation, and then we write down distances to neighbors. So it looks in this particular case, this MD vector is simply yes, the pair distribution function, but we could define it for more general periodic crystals, and then the definition slightly differs. So when we have several points in the unit cell, then we take the average over these distances over atoms in the unit cell up to k neighbors. But theoretically, this is an infinite sequence. So it's an infinite sequence of values which is increasing. But in practice, of course, we are computing it up to k neighbors. So that's a simple vector, vector invariant, but we could make it stronger. Point-wise distribution PDD, which is stronger than PDF. And we proved theoretically that it is actually complete for all crystals in general position. So we don't have counterexamples, but in general position, it's theoretically proved to be complete. So one brief example why PDD is stronger than PDF. The example looks a little bit technical, but it is actually one dimensional. So the unit cell here is from 0 to 8, 4 points, and another periodic sequence with 4 points in the unit cell. And R here is a free parameter. So R here is a parameter between 0 and 1. And for any value of this parameter, if you write down distances between points, they will form the same infinite sequence. It's not hard to prove, but that's how it starts, that sequence. But if you write down the point-wise distance distribution, if you split our distances per point, then there will be difference already with the first neighbors. For all R with parameter, we could distinguish them. So let me go quicker to the crystal isometry principle, because we have computed with PDD invariants on all crystals in the Cambridge structural database and compared them pairwise. So we have taken only pure periodic crystals, no disorder, full geometric data. More than 200 billion pairwise comparisons. But we did it in a hierarchical way. So first comparing AMD vectors, which are very fast to compare, and then only for closest pairs, comparing PDD invariants, which are stronger. And we found we didn't know what to expect. We were testing the strength. So how strong is this PDD invariant? We found 5 isometric duplicates, but with different chemistry. This was surprising. When we looked at these SIG files, we realized that, our distance is exactly zero, because all given coordinates are exactly the same to the last digit. All unit cell parameters, all atomic coordinates are exactly the same. So in 5 cases, 5 pairs. That's one example. This is probably the most striking, because one atom of cadmium was replaced by manganese, which are quite different in the periodic table. And that's why with 5 pairs were investigated by 5 journals. But more importantly, this should not be considered as counterexamples, because it seems physically impossible. When we replace one atom by a larger one, distances to neighbors should be perturbed at least a little bit, and we will immediately see these perturbations. So that's how we came to realizing to the crystal isometry principle. So what our experiment did actually is we mapped all crystals to periodic point sets by forgetting all chemical elements. We compared only periodic sets of atomic centers without chemical information. And this map turned out to be injective moduli isometry. So that's an experimental fact on the Cambridge structural database, but we also have theoretical evidence. So we proved completeness in general position. So general position means very briefly that we have no right angles between our atoms, and also distances are repeated only due to periodicity, only in that case. But even in the CSD, we couldn't find any counterexamples, even in non-general cases. And when I looked at, when I read the very first lecture of Richard Feynman on atomic theory, I noticed that table, which I copied here on that slide. So this is a table from Richard Feynman's lecture. And when I looked at the table, I realized that, Feynman might have thought about it. Because what this table does, this is a very small comparison of very simple cubic structures, right? Different chemistry. But if you forget about chemical elements, all this, the only geometric parameter here relevant for cubical crystals is the distance between closest atoms. And all these distances are different. Some of them are close, but no equal values. So Feynman basically distinguished them geometrically. And we have essentially extended his experiment to the whole Cambridge structural database. And what we realized, that we can now consider all periodic crystals in one common space. So no subdivision by chemical composition, all in one space of isometry classes of periodic point sets, crystal isometry space. So all non-crystals are like visible stars in this space, crystal universe, but all not yet discovered crystals, any new crystal will be also in that space somewhere in a different location, not exactly coinciding if it's not a duplicate again with the previous one. So this is our vision, how we could help chemists with material discovery, because crystal structure prediction currently produces landscapes of pairs, density versus energy. Yeah, density is a good invariant mentioned previously, but just a single value. The whole space is actually hidden behind the clouds. What we see is so-called mountain peaks, so local minima of the energy. But we didn't know even how close these local minima were to each other in that space. But what we are doing is removing this fog and mapping that space by geographic style coordinates. So that we can see how far away they are from each other, but even more. So the whole map can be in principle discovered. Right. So now my time is almost over, but I would like to mention the new results, because the crystal isometry principle was, not everyone has seen it in this audience, but the finite case is also great. Hopefully you might remember from school geometry of the SSS theorem, saying that two triangles are congruent or isometric if and only if they have the same triple of edges, three sides. And this is actually an ideal solution to our mapping problem, because with triangles or clouds of three points, they can be objectively and by continuously identified with triples of numbers, ABC, satisfying an extra triangle inequality. How about more than three points? What if you consider indeed all pairwise distances? So that's again pair distribution function, but in the finite case. This is a strong invariant. So for a finite case, it was formally proved that it is a complete invariant in general position. So in general position, but not for all. So this is a classical example, also known to crystallographers, four points on the plane, forming vertices, so vertices of a trapezium, and a kite example. Non-isometric clouds with the same six pairwise distances. And we have distinguished them by this point-wise distance distribution. So we some matrices, so rows with weights. I could later probably discuss more details, but let me go to the main result. They can be compared continuously by the so-called Earth Mover's distance, which is illustrated on that slide. But let me go to the most interesting discovery. I didn't know it myself until a couple of months ago. So that counterexample from the previous slide is not unique. So see, if you take actually six random distances between four points, they do not form, they do not give us a cloud in the plane. Because the volume of a tetrahedron on these four points should be zero. So that's why we have a polynomial equation on six distances in the plane case. So these are good invariants, but not enough, not good parameters. So the space is actually five dimensional. Six distances minus one equality, five dimensional space. And in this five dimensional space, there is a family of pairs of clouds of four points, non-isometric, that have the same six pairwise distances depending on four parameters. So that single example was not unique. So you go just one dimension down from five to four, and you get a lot of confusion. So six pairwise distances are not enough. And this picture briefly illustrates how it can happen. So let's. So this example was a great motivation for us to actually find the complete invariant. So PDD is conjectured to be complete on the plane. We know that it's not complete in the three-dimensional space. But we have constructed strong invariants. So one type, simplex wise distance distribution. This is an invariant in any metric space. Also conjecture to be complete. But what we have proved the completeness and Lipschitz continuity was proved for the invariant specifically adapted for any Euclidean space. We called it simplex wise centered distribution. Right. So I have no time to introduce it formally, but I could give you a continuous picture now of the space of triangles in a simple case. So if you move the center of mass of a triangle to the origin and fix the most distant point, distant vertex at say the horizontal x-axis, then the position of isometric class of a triangle is then determined by only single point, P2 here. Because the third point will be determined from the center of mass. So this yellow region actually is that configuration space of isometric classes of triangles. And the boundary cases here correspond to isosceles triangles. So one type here, another type here, and the vertices, so with corner points are for equilateral triangles. So of course, these boundary cases should be identified, so we should glue them together. But also we have moved to quadrilaterals, so now we have similar descriptions for four points in the plane, and this procedure works actually for any number of points in any Euclidean space. So that's how the space of parallelograms looks. It's still two-dimensional, that's why the pictures are easy enough. So all parallelograms here can be represented by points in this yellow region. If you take a point on that left hemicircle, you get a rectangle. If you take a point on the vertical axis, you get a rhombus. But all parallelograms are here, and similar high dimensional spaces can be explicitly parameterized for any quadrilaterals and in general for any point clouds. Okay, so Yuri on Monday will talk about the case of molecular graphs when we add edges. So it's a harder case, not only point clouds, but we would like to similarly distinguish different Euclidean graphs on the same vertex sets with complete invariants and continuous metrics. Okay, so I should probably mention the protein data bank. So let me skip with introductions and mention that we have compared pairwisely everything in the PDB on a modest desktop took less than 2 days. So we considered only protein chains and compare them as rigid objects. And that case is actually simpler because our alpha carbon atoms are ordered. The ordered case is simpler. We can compare them by distance matrices. And we have found more than 15,000 pairs with exactly distance zero. And among them, nearly 5,000 pairs that have actually identical coordinates. So all coordinates to the last digits were identical. And we have confirmations from a couple of authors. confirmed, but indeed, LUTs case, LUT with PDB entries should be somehow corrected. So that's a small table, but we have 20 pairs of duplicates that differ by primary sequences of amino acids. So that pair was particularly confirmed. And actually, after our discussion with the PDB validation team, we noticed that five PDB entries that we have found as duplicates were recently changed. But we have more. We have more. So that's a continuous version of our PDB universe. Yeah, no time right now. Let me finish with summary. So in geometric data science, we consider it generally viazometric classification problem for periodic structures. So that's how we describe the crystallized entry space. But also more recently, we solved this problem for finite point clouds of unlabeled points. But in general, we could consider other data objects, not only point sets or periodic structures, and also up to different equivalence relations, not necessarily isometry. But the problem remains the same. So find the complete invariant and the continuous metric computable on this in this invariants, and ultimately describe the moduli space. So this is a list of our recently published papers, so all linked on my web page. Thank you.